Okay, so we're almost there. So the next talk is an exploit generation about a tool called Chainsaw from the University of Illinois at Chicago. And jump right into it, please.
Yeah, hi. My name is Abir, and I'm going to present today a talk about workflow-based exploit generation in web applications using static and dynamic analyses. This is a joint work with Burhanu Ishit, Rigel Jumemo, and Venkat Venkatarishnan from the University of Illinois at Chicago. A typical three-tier web application has a browser that renders the client-side code, a database, and a web server that contains a set of modules that represent the logic of the application. To perform an operation, such as purchasing an item from an online store, users are expected to follow a developer's intended workflow. For example, in the online store, users are expected to first view some items, add them to a shopping cart, and then check out. Web applications enforce this concept by having an implicit navigation policy that guides the user and the application interactions. Users are also expected to provide some anticipated inputs to the application. And the applications enforce that or checks that by having conditional statements and database queries, for example, to check and verify the user input. This simple web app has three modules that represent its item purchasing logic. Let's assume that view.php is public, meaning that this script does not require authentication or authorization to access that script. And let's also assume that checkout.php is protected, it's not public. And it has a sensitive sync that is vulnerable to SQL injection, for example. The following is an example of an exploit that will navigate the application from a public script. In here, it's view.php to the vulnerable module that contains the vulnerable sync in order to exploit that. And the last HTTP request provides the malicious input that will be used in the vulnerable query. The other inputs in blue, we need them. Those are benign inputs. We need them in order to derive the execution to reach checkout.php, the vulnerable module that we want to generate an exploit for. So giving the source code of an application, the problem that we are tackling in this work is to find the sequence of HTTP requests that will navigate the application from a public module to the module that contains the vulnerable sync that we want to exploit. And we want to have that automatically. To find such HTTP requests, or sequences, there are some challenges. First is pathfinding. What are the modules that we need to visit, and in what order to invoke the module that contains the vulnerable sync that we want to exploit? We call the set of modules a navigation sequence. The other problem is that the navigation maps of web applications that show how modules are connected to each other are not explicit. They are implicitly defined in the source code. It is very common in web applications to have multiple navigation sequences between two modules. If we have that, the challenge is that which one of those navigation sequences we have to explore first for efficiency reasons. For example, as you can see in this graph, There are three possible navigation sequences between the home page and m7.php, the vulnerable script. Which navigation sequence should we choose first? Is it the shortest, or is there any better ranking strategy that we should follow? If we have a candidate navigation sequence, the other challenge is to find the execution path inside each module that we have to explore in order to construct a global execution path, which is a path that starts from the public script to the vulnerable sync. Second-order attacks, such as second-order SQL injection and stored cross-site scripting, require exploiting two distinct syncs in two steps. Usually, in the first step, a specific malicious content is stored in the database using a write query, and then a second sync reads that input and renders that input to the browser without sanitization. The challenge that we are tackling in this work is how to generate exploits for multiple syncs. Our approach to generate SQL injection and cross-site scripting exploits is to first statically identify all vulnerable syncs in the application. We call those vulnerable syncs exploit seeds. And then we infer the developer intended workflow of the applications. We use those inferred workflow graphs to find all possible navigation sequences, rank them, and then within each candidate navigation sequence, we find all feasible global execution paths. We collect the constraints from those paths, and then we use the constraint solver to find a solution, or basically to find the exploit, or to generate the exploit. We've implemented our approach in a tool called Chainsaw. It's the first tool that is able to chain a sequence of HTTP requests that direct the execution to vulnerable syncs. It is built for PHP. However, the techniques that we've used and we've implemented are general and applicable to other web platforms. The tool gets the application source code, the database data and the schema, and some attack patterns or the attack specifications related to SQL injection and cross-site scripting. And it outputs exploits in form of HTTP requests. The first step in our approach to generate exploits is seed generation. This component analyzes individually each module in the application to find exploitable syncs and prunes out the syncs that are not vulnerable. The intuition behind this step is that usually the exploitable syncs are a small subset of all syncs in the application. And we want to use that small subset at the beginning of the analysis so that we can use the later expensive analyses on those small subsets of syncs. To do so, our tool explores statically all execution paths between sources, user input in PHP, user input stored in get, post, request arrays, and sensitive syncs such as MySQL query, echo print, and so on. It constructs for each execution path between a source and a sync, it constructs two formulas, a path formula that contains constraints derived from the path conditions and from the statements that depends on user input. The other formula is the attack formula, which contains the constraints derived from the sink itself. Let's consider this, this very simple example. In here, we have two possible execution paths between the source and the sink, the MySQL query. And for the path on the left, the tool collects the path conditions and add them to the path formula FP, and also the statements that process user input. And then it examines the sync. And since the sync is a select query and the user input is using the where clause, it infers that a tautology attack is appropriate. The conjunction of the two formulas are sent to the solver, and if there is a solution for that formula, it means that this sync is vulnerable. And we do that for all paths, for all syncs in the application. To address part of the pathfinding challenge that I've mentioned earlier, the workflow inference component builds the intended workflow of all the applications. The resulted graph is called the general workflow graph. We use that graph to find navigation sequences and rank them. This is an example of a general workflow graph for an application. The nodes here are all the modules in that application, and the edges are basically the navigation features, such as links or forms, extracted from the source code. And the weights on the edges, for example, the weight here on that edge, the log of the weight represents all the total number of the execution paths in the destination module, the addcat.php. We use this graph to find all possible navigation sequences between two modules, a public and a vulnerable module, and then we use some ranking strategy. As you can see from this general workflow graph that we have two possible navigation sequences, one between roam.php and create.php. The first one is through dashboard.php with a total cost of 10, the summation of the weights of the edges. And the other one through check.php with a total cost of 10. The tool chooses the first navigation sequence because fewer execution paths means less analysis time and constraint solving time. So that's our strategy. Workflow, the next component in our approach is workflow refinement component. It finds all feasible global execution paths using the navigation within the navigation sequence generated from the previous component. It builds a new graph called the refined workflow graph. To address the local and the global path exploration challenge, we need a representation of the modules in the applications at the level of their execution path. And for that reason, we construct the refined workflow graph. The nodes in that graph represent all execution paths for all the modules in the navigation sequence. And each node has two properties, preconditions and summary. The preconditions represent the conditional statements along that execution path inside the node. And the summary represents the effect of taking that execution path on the global state of the application, the changes on the super globals in PHP, like session, get, and post arrays. Now, to connect the graph, to connect execution paths, different execution paths of belonging to different modules, we use the following strategy. We connect, for example, node R2 with node D3 that belongs to different modules. If and only if the summary, the preconditions of D3 can be satisfied by the summary of R2. After constructing the graph, the next challenge is to intelligently decide which path to take in that final workflow graph. So this is a very simple refined workflow graph. Typically in web applications, the final workflow graph contains a large number of paths, possible global execution paths. So we need a very good search algorithm to limit the path explosion problem. For that reason, we've proposed a key heuristic that we called a summary history, which is basically a mechanism to remember the traversal history. For example, if the search is at the node R2, it adds the summary of that node or that execution path to the summary history. And then it checks all of its outgoing edges. And since the summary history of R2 is consistent with the preconditions of D3, for example, it adds the summary of D3 to the summary history. So now we have two constraints in the summary history. We use those two constraints to check that with the preconditions of C2 and C1 in the next level. And since, for example, the summary history is consistent with the preconditions, the tool produces this global execution path as a feasible execution path that starts from a public module and ends at an execution path in the vulnerable module. So, and the search algorithm will continue after that to find all possible feasible global execution paths. The last step in our approach to generate exploits, now we have all those feasible execution paths, we use the solver to collect the constraints and solve those constraints. If there is a satisfiable solution for those constraints, the solver would generate a model, and we use the values in that model to construct the HTTP requests. We've evaluated our approach on 9 small to large web applications. We've chose those applications mainly to compare the results of our work with other previously related works, such as Ardila, CracksWeb, RIPS, and so on. Our tool generated 199 working exploits, 169 exploits are first order SQL injection and cross-site scripting combined, and 30 exploits are a second order SQL injection and stored cross-site scripting exploits with no false positives. The total analysis time for all applications ranges from 10 to 600 minutes. There are some factors for such long analysis time. First is that the refined workflow graph for large applications are usually huge. So the search algorithm has to traverse so many paths in the graph to find all possible feasible execution paths. And the other factor is the frequent invocation of the solver and the added constraint solving time. The maximum length of the navigation sequences for all applications ranges from 2 to 5. This number indicates that our tool is capable of generating exploits for deeply located sinks in the application. This is an example of a stored cross-site scripting exploit generated automatically by our tool from a Schoolmate application. The first step exploits or inserts a malicious content through a site text user input at the query at line 5, the vulnerable query at line 5. And since header.php, where this the module that contains this vulnerable script is public, the tool generated only one HTTP request because the navigation sequence for that module has a length of one. So this is the generated exploit that inserts that malicious content into the database. The second step exploits the print function at line 3, because that print function prints the value stored in text variable that is retrieved, it contains the same variable retrieved from the query at line 1. So basically what does that mean? What that means is that this print function prints out the malicious content that we've inserted in the first exploit without sanitization. So if any user visits login.php where that print function is located, the malicious content will be executed automatically. We've compared the results as I mentioned before, the results with other closely related work, such as Ardila and CrackSweb. Our tool generated 56 more exploits than Ardila and 52 more exploits than CrackSweb. There are many reasons for that. We have a detailed discussion in the paper about that. But one of the main reasons is that the techniques that we've used in this work allow for better coverage, and therefore we find more vulnerabilities, and we can generate exploits for those identified vulnerabilities. We've also compared the C generation component results with other related vulnerability analysis tools, such as RIPS. As you can see from the table, our tool identified more vulnerable sinks than all of those three tools. And there are two main reasons for that. We have a more precise analysis. We've implemented a path-sensitive analysis between all sources and sinks in the application, and we've also derived constraints from the database so that we can make sure that the exploits that we generate for the sinks will be accepted if they are stored in the database. And none of these works have this type of this type of analysis. And to conclude, our tool is the first tool that generates exploits spanning across several HTTP requests. It automatically generates exploits by using the navigation structure of web applications, and we've used also several search techniques. Our tool generated 199 exploits, 30 of them are second order exploits, and the tool significantly outperforms several peer work.
Thank you. First. So we have time for a few questions here. Please step up to the microphone, state your name and